Dear organizers, dear fellow panel members, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Panagiotis Zaradoukas, and I'm here tonight with you, along with Dr. Georgios Michalakopoulos, to present you a part of our research concerning the use of critical discourse analysis theory for the analysis of the Turkish political discourse. First, we would like to thank the organizers of the Vocum conference for their support and excellent organization. This presentation is part of the research interests of the Language and Politics Laboratory of the Department of Foreign Languages, Translation and Interpreting of the Ionian University. And let me start by presenting you the definition of the word vatan. It is homeland. According to the Turkish dictionary of Piskulioglu, the definition of the word vatan refers to the synonym word yurt. Therefore, yurt is firstly a piece of land on which a people live dominantly and form their culture and civilization. Secondly, it is defined as the place where the person was born, raised, lived in, or the father's home. The definition of the word vatan by the Ayverdis and Topaloulou dictionary is almost the same as you can see in the slide. The last part of the definition about the concept of vatan in Sufism is not pertinent to our research, but we added it in the slide in order to present you another interesting aspect of the word as the realm of spirits. Dr. Michalakopoulos will explain you why the extensions of the concept of homeland are not limited to these definitions, but on the contrary, the concept has evolved over the decades and especially in recent years in Turkey. Mr. Michalakopoulos.
Yes, thank you very much, Panagiotis. I want to thank you, Mitsu, for this refreshing conference, because I see so many young people organizing such a very good conference. Thank you. So, in order to be brief, I will summarize the following three concepts by saying, first, one must keep in mind two things. First, in Turkish language and Turkish psyche, the term vatan carries both the concept of territory and of political and legal provisions, as presented in Turkish Constitution, where a clear distinction is made between vatan and millet, that is the nation. And the second thing to keep in mind is that this term is highly contested in modern Turkey by political groups. Before and during the institution of the Turkish Republic, Ziya Gökalp, the intellectual father of Turkish nationalism, made the distinction between a Turkish vatan, an Arabic vatan, and an Islamic vatan, three different homelands. In other words, and summarizing the slide that you are watching, we have departed from a personal, vague, and sentimental notion, that is one's birthplace, to a collective, delimited, and sentimental one, that is a people's national home territory. Also, various divisions have been proposed, but all fall already to the already mentioned two terms. Finally, the particular relation between society and space was transformed into a vehicle for imposing order and identity. Next slide, Panayotis.
Yes.
Thank you. Now, let me present you in brief some fundamentals on CDA, on critical discourse analysis. As far as the discourse analysis and the critical discourse analysis are concerned, let me say this. When using the critical discourse analysis, one does not try to prove, but rather to show three things: how the research concept affects text and talk, then what are the underlying beliefs connecting the transmitter to the receivers, and finally, in what way these beliefs are produced and reproduced by text and talk. And in this way, ideology is spread, power and social control acquired. Political games of sovereignty, whether national or international, are usually unfolded in a particular time, place, and social place, and social space, sorry. The factor of religion is important in countries like Turkey, where the leader is made public discourses in which religious and political are both assimilated into one aspect. And also, we must remember that this synthesis is something between Oriental and a Western one. In other words, it is the way they look at history. The Oriental way is to bring history to the present, and the Western way is to live history in the past. Next slide, Panayotis.
Yes.
So, what about territoriality and the lack of ideological neutrality in political discourse? What about it? Well, the key phrase related to political discourse is this: persuade in order to gain power. And then, what is the importance of the notions of space and territory in political discourse? They are very important from an anthropological, psychological, and linguistic cognitive point of view. And of course, all depends on the transmitter's credibility and gained legitimacy as far as the proposed ideological and the values systems are concerned. And let me use what an expert on communication suggested. Words we use in a political speech are never neutral, but they carry a form of power that reflects the speaker's interests and aspirations.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Michalakopoulos. And now I will present you briefly the main speeches that form the backbone of our research. We decided to present you three political speeches delivered by Turkey's president Recep Tayyip Erdogan after the failed coup attempt of July 2016. The Turkish president, about the first speech, of 15 October 2016, the Turkish president gives the first speech on the beginning of the academic year in at the Rize University. The speech was delivered 3 months after the failed coup attempt, which marked a turning point in modern Turkish history. In addition, at the same time, the Turkish army launched the Operation Euphrates Shield in Syria in order to secure the Turkish-Syrian border. The speech is highly emotional discourse, built around Erdogan's beloved Bible of natural borders and borders of the heart. He states that Turkey is not just Turkey. Turkey must stand by its brothers and take care of the oppressed people living in the wider geographical region of Turkey. Erdogan refers to the Turkish national oath, which was adopted by the last Ottoman parliament and is indirectly linked to the borders of the Turkish president's heart, which includes area that once belonged to the Ottoman Empire and now belong to other states. According to the president, it is Turkey's duty and right to help countries it considers important, such as Iraq, Syria, Georgia, Crimea, Karabakh, Azerbaijan, etc. In all these places, which are connected by historical, cultural, and social ties with Turkey, one will definitely meet some of the traces of the ancestors. Therefore, Turkey has every right to defend and care for areas where the Turkish identity remains unchanged over the centuries. The second speech, that of 1st September 2017, is delivered as part of an event organized by the Justice and Development Party, AKP, the party in which Erdogan belongs, on the Feast of Sacrifice. This speech comes a few months after the referendum of April 2017 to change the constitution and a year after the failed coup. We note here that the state of emergency declared in the aftermath of the coup has been in place for over a year, and the relations between Turkey and the United States have deteriorated. In his speech, Erdogan referred to the enemies of the homeland and stated that the real purpose of those who try to devalue concepts such as nation, flag, homeland, state, is to ensure the dissolution of the country and the nation. For this reason, Turkey will do everything in its power to prevent territorial fragmentation scenarios, such as those unfolding in Syria, Iraq, the Balkans, and Rakhine. Regarding the latter, Erdogan referred to contacts he had with foreign leaders to discuss the issue of Rohingya Muslims. He states, "Even if no one speaks, we will speak." While those who wonder why Turkey interferes in areas that have no geographical relationship with it, his answer to them is to look in the history books. The last speech, that of 24 September 2018, was delivered at an event of the Turkish American Steering Committee, TASC, in the US. The speech was delivered some months after the win of Erdogan in the presidential elections, which ensured the country's transition to a new constitution. The win was followed by a particularly difficult summer for Turkish-American relations. In his speech, the president stated that Turkey has a natural geography and a geography of the heart, adding that the borders of the heart of our country far exceed its natural borders. He referred to the Turkish state support for the Rohingya and the Somali brothers, and to demonstrate the state's tangible support, he cited Turkey's contribution to the establishment and operation of schools and hospitals in Somalia. At the same time, he refers to the efforts made by Turkey to strengthen its tie with other Turkic republics. Finally, concerning the country's relations with the Muslim world, the president states that the geography of the heart knows no distances and obstacles, and reminds, in fact, that all Turks have one nation, one flag, one homeland, one state. Now, Mr. Michalakopoulos will give you some conclusions.
Can I have 1 minute?
Yes, unless we have pressing questions. I don't see anything in the chat.
1 minute is enough.
Yes, go on, you can wrap up.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Now, these are the preliminary conclusions. I think the two images at the right cover all aspects of our remarks. First, the main purpose of the speaker is to instill to the audience the sense of unity. Secondly, to disorientate the public opinion. Third, the concept of homeland is manipulated. Fourth, to ideologize and manipulate the geopolitical space. And finally, in short, I have to say that Turkey is struggling with itself between what it feels to be and what it is. Perhaps the time of self-realization is not far, but until then, Turkey will constitute a very interesting case study. Thank you very much.